Tonight, dozens of Filipinos trapped in Gaza finally allowed to go into Egypt via the Rafah border crossing.
Two allies of former Philippine President Duterte lose their leadership posts at the House of Representatives.
Philippine authorities arrest officials of a civic group that's been accused of cultish practices which involve child abuse.
And former U.S. President Donald Trump testifies in his civil fraud case in New York.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, approval from Israel and Egypt for Filipinos and their Palestinian family members in Gaza to finally cross Egypt's Rafah border. But their passage into Egypt comes with conditions. Zed Hernandez has tonight's top story.
After 3 days of suspension, the limited evacuation of foreign nationals at the Rafah crossing has resumed, paving the way for the exit of Filipinos, including 19 minors, 3 infants, and 2 pregnant women.
46 will be able to cross. And we will update you on their situation once they are in Cairo. They will be given a few days before they will fly home to the Philippines. So they will be home within the week.
Almost 100 remaining Filipinos in Gaza are hesitant to leave for fear that their Palestinian spouses will be left behind. The Philippine government has been making appeals on their behalf, and results are looking positive after Israel and Egypt both agreed to let them cross if they pass clearance procedures, while also banking on a specific guarantee from the Philippines.
Yun ang deal. They have to directly fly out of Egypt and go straight to the Philippines. So within 72 hours, yung nag-cross a border, kailangan ilipad papuntang Maynila na. So ganun yung magiging proseso. Yeah. They cannot stay in Egypt.
Meanwhile, a caregiver in Israel, Monica Biboso, recounts her harrowing experience during the October 7 Hamas attack in Kibbutz Beri near the Gaza border. This is the home of Monica's employer. They were trapped in the Mamad or bomb shelter for 16 hours and almost suffocated from smoke when Hamas set the house on fire as they opened fire.
Nangihina na po ako, wala na po akong lakas, hindi na po ako makahinga. Nasabi ko kaya ko para sa mga anak ko. Kailangan ko pa po ako sila makita. Ang mga anak ko po at pamilya ko po, yung asawa ko.
As the Hamas unleashed death and destruction throughout their kibbutz, Monica was frantically messaging several Filipinos, including Grace Prodigo Cabrera. But Grace stopped responding, and it was later confirmed that she was among the dead.
Lahat po kami close, maparang kami ng mga magkakapatid na po kaming lahat doon. Si Ate Grace sobrang bait po niya. Kaya sobrang sakit po nung nalbalitaan naming wala siya. Hindi po kami makapaniwala.
On Monday afternoon, Grace's remains were brought back to the Philippines and received by her husband and family.
May mga tabi na malalam mo. Sana kami hindi mo matanggap. Para sa amin talaga, buhay pa si Grace.
Sobrang sakit po, ma'am. Hindi ko po ma-explain kung gaano kasakit.
The Israeli embassy assured the families of Grace and 3 other Filipino fatalities a lifetime assistance from the Israeli government for being victims of terror. In Gaza, Israel's airstrikes and ground assaults continue to intensify with the aim of destroying Hamas and freeing 240 hostages. More than 10,000 Palestinians have lost their lives in the war, over 4,000 of them children, according to Palestinian authorities and humanitarian groups. Meanwhile, 42 Filipinos arrived from Israel Tuesday. According to Ambassador Lilo, another batch of returning Filipinos is being processed, while majority of the over 30,000 OFWs have chosen to stay in Israel. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
A petition filed at the Philippine Supreme Court challenges the 2022 transfer of confidential funds to the office of Vice President Sara Duterte. The petition was filed by a group of civil society members and former government officials. They argue that the transfer of 125 million pesos from the office of the president had usurped the legislative powers of Congress. Their petition asks the Supreme Court to have the funds returned to the Philippine Treasury. Petitioner Barry Gutierrez points out that the Vice President's 2022 budget had no line item for confidential funds. The Budget Department had approved the transfer. It said the funds were taken from the 2022 budget's contingency fund.
At heart, what we're really asking for is a declaration of unconstitutionality. And that is essentially anchored on the simple fact that the whether you call it a transfer, whether you call it a release or an augmentation, the money went into a supposed confidential fund under the office of the Vice President. And the truth of the matter is, if you look at the General Appropriations Act of 2022, there is no such confidential fund item under the OVP budget. If we'll recall, the 2022 budget for OVP was still applied for and is still anchored on the submissions of the outgoing Vice President, former Vice President Leni Robredo, and she did not ask for confidential funds, neither was she given any confidential funds. So what we're saying here is, under the Constitution, there is no power on the part of any executive agency to create a fund which is not created by law first.
The office of the Vice President says it welcomes the petition. It sees the Supreme Court as the proper venue to settle the issue.
Umaasa kami na ang dunong ng Korte Suprema ay magiging daan upang tuluyang matapos ang usapin na ito. Ngayon naman, tutukan natin ang mahirap na tungkulin sa pagpapataas ng antas ng kalidad ng edukasyon sa ating bansa at pagprotekta sa ating mga mag-aaral at mga kawani ng Department of Education mula sa lahat ng uri ng banta at pang-aabuso.
Several Philippine senators expressed dismay over the supposed leak of information from their executive session Monday. The closed-door session had tackled the confidential and intelligence funds of Vice President and Concurrent Education Chief Sara Duterte. Senator Jinggoy Estrada lashed out at a news report which named senators who allegedly wanted the funds restored to the office of the Vice President and the Education Department. Estrada insists there is no truth to the supposed leaked information.
There was a news report that identified 8 or 9 senators who wanted to restore the confidential and intelligence fund of the Vice President and the Department of Education. And I wish to tell the people of the Philippines that there was no votation that happened yesterday with regard to the intelligence fund of the Vice President and the Department of Education. In fact, we had an executive session. And I do not know who of our colleagues who scooped or leaked our conversation to this media outlet. This is the first time that I encountered a scoop or a leakage. I do not know. I do not want to name names. This is a violation of our rules.
Estrada did not identify the media outlet that reported the supposed leak, but he recommends that it be summoned to explain. However, Senator Francis Escudero brands the report as a mere rumor and says no information was leaked.
The account is not accurate and that is not what transpired in executive session. I hope, Senator Jinggoy, you and I will not be sanctioned for saying part of what happened. The facts contained in the article, Mr. President, Your Honor, is not a leak. Chismis yun. So there is no leak to speak of really with respect to what truly transpired in the executive session. An attempt perhaps to create a story about it.
Philippine authorities arrest the leaders of the Socorro Bayanihan Services Incorporated. The controversial civic group based in Surigao del Norte province is accused of human trafficking and child abuse. Sherry Ann Torres reports.
The National Bureau of Investigation has arrested the leader of the Socorro Bayanihan Services Incorporated, J. Ren Skilario, and 12 others. This is in connection with trafficking and child abuse charges.
Sir, you have the right to remain silent. You also have the, anything you say will be used against you in court of law. You have the right to a lawyer if you cannot appoint one.
Before the arrest, the Senate hearing uncovered more irregularities committed by the group. This is a list of couples who reportedly lost their child while living in Sitio Capihan as members of SBSI. One of them was the baby of Randolph Balbarino, who was born in breech position in 2020 but only lived for 2 days. Balbarino says his wife was already in great pain when village health workers assisting her decided to just pull out their baby.
Wala akong magawa kasi yung asawa ko nagsasabi na wala daw akong tiwala kay Senyor Aguila.
Local officials have a theory why many children died in Sitio Capihan.
Capihan members, wala kaming record na nagpapinital. Yung mga buntis, talagang walang record namin sa RHU, no, na walang nagpapinital, walang nanganak ng health facility. Kasi yung health center, yun yung birthing ng LGU, ang Socorro.
Balbarino says 50% of his income as fisherman automatically goes to SBSI as member donation. But not only that, the Department of Social Welfare and Development says the agency consistently extends assistance to indigent families of Socorro. Around 200 of them are SBSI members.
Simula po noong 2019, nakapagbigay tayo ng educational grants and health grants sa mga beneficiaries, including their rice subsidies. At yan po ay naibigay natin sa 202 na household members. Yan po ay in the form of cash. Yan po ay 600 pesos po kada buwan.
According to the information, dito sa pidabit ng isang membro nila ay binabawasan ng 1,000 na pupunta sa SBSI. But this happened after the fact na. After your distribution, merong umiikot itong si Flordelis Ilandag na according to Senior Aguila, ay kanilang treasurer. Ito'y nangungulikta at iniskortan pa ng mga Aguila.
The DSWD confirms to have been receiving the same information from SBSI members.
Ang Capihan po ay sila po lahat na consider as totally damaged yung houses nila doon kasi heavily hit sila ng UDET. So nakatanggap ang bawat household ng 10,000 po. So, ang narinig ko po na mga na-report po, may nagbigay ng 6,000. Parang may kinolekta na 6,000. May iba din po na 5,000, so 50-50.
Ilyas Chloe, who is now 15 years old, tells the panel she was only 13 when an officer of SBSI, Janet Ahok, locked her in a room with a 21-year-old man who raped her.
Dili na tinuod, sir.
Kung hindi totoo, may panahon po nga pong pinatawag ako, tapos tinanong na kung ano apelyido ko. Tingnan mo nga saan galing yung apelyido mo, tapos ikaw pa yung may karapatang mag-adyos.
Before the hearing ended, Justice Undersecretary Nicolas Felix T. reports to the panel they have filed 20 cases against 13 SBSI officials. These include illegal solemnization of child marriage, child abuse, and the non-bailable qualified trafficking in persons charges. T. says the government is likely to file additional cases against the SBSI.
Clearly, there are other incidents that we can look into, such as the children who died, no, in childbirth, as well as the abuse of the senior citizen who testified earlier.
We invoke on the principle that the rights of the parties cannot be prejudiced by mere allegation. We have our courts of justice.
Sherian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine lawmakers replaced two key allies of former President Rodrigo Duterte as House Deputy Speakers. The power shift comes after the lower chamber defended itself from Duterte's previous attacks. R.G. Cruz reports.
I move to elect Representative Antonio Tonipet Albano as Deputy Speaker, Vice Representative Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. I move to elect Representative Yasser Alonto Balindong as Deputy Speaker, Vice Representative Isidro Ungab.
Is there any objection? The Chair hears none. The motion is approved. Majority Leader.
No one objected when the majority moved to replace two key allies of former President Rodrigo Duterte and Vice President Sara Duterte. Former President and Pampanga Representative Gloria Arroyo and Davao City Representative Isidro Ungab as Deputy Speakers, with Isabela Representative Antonio Albano and Lanao del Sur Representative Yasser Balindong. In a statement, Majority Leader Manuel Jose Dalipi explained this was because the two lawmakers refused to sign a resolution which the leadership pushed. House lawmakers spent the better part of their first session after more than a one-month-long break approving House Resolution 1414, upholding the integrity and dignity of the House and the speakership of Martin Romualdez. This almost a month after former President Rodrigo Duterte in a TV interview slammed the House for taking away the confidential funds of his daughter. The resolution named no one and only referred to the House objecting to any attacks on its integrity, dignity, and independence, as well as threats to its members.
There were threats against one of the House members and the House itself. So I believe this is a show of solidarity, not only towards our Speaker, but for the institution as a whole and its sanctity.
There was a grave threat on the life of one of our members, the Honorable Franz Castro. But with respect to the whole House, was the integrity of the House challenged at any time during the break?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I believe it was put into question.
If not for Albay Representative Edsel Lagman's questions, the principal sponsor of the measure, Senior Deputy Speaker Aurelio Dong Gonzalez, would not admit who really is the reason for the resolution, but not before signing on the spot. Gonzalez is a member of the PDP Laban, which Duterte chairs.
I hate to say this, Mr. Chairman, but when I heard the word rotten, of course, I felt bad.
I also would feel bad hearing that accusation that the House is rotten. But may we know who uttered that statement? Was it a comic or a leader or previous leader of this country? Why is the name of that accuser so sacrosanct that we cannot mention it before this body?
Before I will answer, I will resign now as member and officer of PDP Laban, the former president Rodrigo Roa Duterte, the one who said.
On Facebook, the former president explained the importance of standing by principles and how he won't countenance setting aside principles for convenience. Another PDP Laban stalwart, Senator Ronald De La Rosa, shrugged off Gonzalez's resignation.
That's their prerogative as members. Why are they not attending?
Leaders of other parties backed the resolution, including other members of PDP Laban. Dalipe said that lawmakers have the obligation to make sure political power is not abused. Romualdez himself would break his silence with assurances he is ready to fight for the House.
Tatayo ako laban sa sinuman na mananakot sa atin para masunod lamang ang gusto nila. Itindig ako tayong lahat para sa kapakanan ng bayan.
The Speaker also defended the House's decision to realign the VP's confidential funds, which came months after the Vice President quit his party.
Wala pong personalan dito, trabaho lang. Let not our hard work be undermined by a dissatisfied few whose only intentions to sow divisiveness.
Dalipe explained the resolution was too important as it was in defense of the institution. While they respect dissent, Dalipe says the leadership feels it is important to be united amidst challenges and to be of the same mind as the leadership. Dalipe said that by refusing to sign, the two show disagreement with the leadership. When the leadership feels it is better off being with those of the same mind. In a statement on Monday, Arroyo explained she was out of the country but maintained she supports Romualdez. It would be her second demotion since May when she was demoted from Senior Deputy Speaker. Ungab, meantime, accepted his fate, saying he had no bitterness or rancor as he thanked his supporters and affirmed his support for the administration. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine authorities uncover fresh leads in the killing of Misamis Occidental radioman Juan Humalon. The broadcaster's wife recalls a possible motive behind her husband's death. We have this report.
Authorities in northern Mindanao say they are putting up more checkpoints amid follow-up operations regarding the killing of broadcaster Juan Humalon last Sunday. In Calamba, Misamis Occidental, the Northern Mindanao Police Director visited Humalon's wake Tuesday. Brigadier General Ricardo Layog Jr. says police are working on some leads to unmask those behind the killing. Talking to police, Humalon's wife Cheribel disclosed she saw the gunman fleeing after shooting her husband dead inside the booth of his own radio station.
Bukas din ako, nakita ko yung motor single doon nakapark sa may kanto. Then, sumakay yung dalawang tao. Then, ang sabi ko, police, tabang. So, tumingin sila sa akin. Then siguro, natumba silang tatlo.
Humalon's wife on Tuesday said her husband had won a case before his death over a land dispute that sought to take over the lot where their radio station is located. She said the RTC has already ruled in favor of their lawsuit. A separate case has also been filed for the annulment of the title.
Sa land po namin, sir, nag-file kami ng criminal case falsification of public documents doon sa MPC Oropita City, sir. Nag-file doon, sir, yung husband ko. Kasi po yung lupa namin dito, yung nakapirma ng mga deed of sale ay puro matagal lang namatay, sir.
Brigadier General Layog says investigators were on the trail of some fresh leads a day after they published composite sketches of one of the suspects.
Lahat po nung angulo na nabanggit before, lahat yun na open pa rin po.
According to the police, at least three men directly participated in Humalon's killing, but they were also not discounting more people could have been involved.
May mga nagsabi na magbibigay ng reward. Mangyayari dyan, mas marami po na mga kababayan natin ang magbibigay ng information sa madaling kalutasan nito pong insidente na ito.
Police in nearby provinces have also been put on alert for possible witnesses or information that could lead to the suspects. The Mindanao Independent Press Council, or MIPC, believes the motive behind Humalon's killing is personal, but it calls on the PNP to conduct a thorough probe. Cheribel believes her husband did not offend anyone in his broadcast, which is only meant for entertainment. In the meantime, the Presidential Task Force on Media Security says a 100,000 peso reward has been put up for the arrest of the perpetrators. The PNP, for its part, says one of their priorities remains tracking down the vehicles used by the perpetrators, with police now saying there are indications they could have switched vehicles during their escape. Rafi Santos, ABS-CBN News, Misamis Occidental.
Two Philippine environmental activists questioned the Justice Department's impartiality in its ongoing probe of their perjury case. Janila Castro and Jed Tamano filed counter-affidavits citing an earlier claim by Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla that they retracted their statements due to peer pressure. Their lawyer, Dino De Leon, insists the two were abducted by the military and coerced to issuing affidavits of surrender. The Defense Department filed perjury raps against the two after they disowned their affidavits of surrender in September. Next in the news, details of former U.S. President Trump's testimony in his civil fraud trial.
The World Tonight returns after this short break.
We're back on The World Tonight. Former U.S. President Trump delivers a rambling testimony at his civil fraud trial in New York. He complained of unfair treatment, but the New York Attorney General insists numbers don't lie. This report from our North American News Bureau correspondent, Dawn Tagala.
Mr. Trump has repeatedly and consistently misrepresented and inflated the value of his assets.
New York Attorney General Letitia James is seeking to fine former President Donald Trump $250 million, accusing him of fraudulently manipulating the assessed value of his trophy properties such as the Trump Tower in New York City and Mar-a-Lago Estate in Florida. New York State lawyers have argued that by allegedly pumping up the value of his properties, the former president won favorable financing terms at a time when lenders declined to do business with Trump. Even Trump's former lawyer and fixer Michael Cohen recently testified that Trump directed him to doctor financial statements to boost his net worth.
At the end of the day, the only thing that matters are the facts and the numbers. And numbers, my friends, don't lie.
But facts didn't seem to matter to the defiant former president, who believes that his testimony went well during Monday's hearing.
I think it went very well. I think you were there and you listened and you see what a scam this is. This is a case that should have never been brought. It's a case that should be dismissed immediately. The fraud was on behalf of the court. The court was the fraudster in this case. They made references to assets that were very valuable, and they said they had no idea what the numbers were when they said $18 million for Mar-a-Lago, and it's 50 to 100 times that amount by any estimation. It's a terrible thing that's happened here.
James said not quite so to the twice impeached, four times indicted Trump.
Today we heard from Donald Trump in our case against him, other defendants, and the Trump Organization. He rambled, he hurled insults, but we expected that. At the end of the day, the documentary evidence demonstrated that, in fact, he falsely inflated his assets to basically enrich himself and his family. He continued to persistently engage in fraud. The numbers don't lie, and Mr. Trump obviously can engage in all of these distractions, and that what he committed on the stand today, engaging in distractions and engaging in name calling. But I will not be bullied. I will not be harassed. This case will go on.
Next on the stand on Wednesday is Trump's daughter, Ivanka, who is not a defendant in this case. New York AG James is not only seeking $250 million in fines, but restrictions that would stop the Trump family from ever doing business in the state of New York. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, New York.
U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen will meet Chinese Vice Premier He Lifeng in San Francisco this week. Their talks will be held ahead of America's hosting of the APEC summit. The meeting aims to deepen a fledgling economic dialogue between the world's two superpowers. The U.S. Treasury Department says the meeting will also convene the new economic and financial forums launched by the two countries in October. Yellen's first met China's new economic czar in July when she visited Beijing to stabilize deteriorating U.S.-China relations.
Inflation in the Philippines slows down in October, mainly due to lower prices of agricultural products. The details from Lady Vicentio.
Headline inflation dropped to 4.9% in October from 6.1% in September. The Philippine Statistics Authority says the slowdown was driven by lower inflation in food and non-alcoholic beverages, particularly in agricultural products. Restaurants and accommodation also registered lower inflation with a decrease in input prices. Price monitoring showed a drop in rice prices in October, driving rice inflation to 13.2% from September's 17.9%. But even as rice inflation fell, PSA says prices are still higher year on year. RCBC Chief Economist Michael Ricafort stressed how the lack of severe weather disturbances became an advantage for local agriculture and food supply.
Food accounts for about a third of the inflation basket. So that's why it's very important. Without storm damage, we saw already some easing in the prices of agricultural products, especially vegetables, as well as rice, because we have seen the early harvest season since middle of September and into October, and that fundamentally added to the supply of palay and leading to some easing in the prices of palay.
However, an agri group says rice prices could still increase after rice farms in Isabela were damaged by pests. Because of this, agriculture group Samhang Industriya ng Agrikultura expects a drop in palay production.
Mga area ng Isabela kasi tinamaan ng steam war, bumaba yung ani nila. Tapos yung iba din dito sa lowland area, may eastern part, medyo mababa yung ani. Yung expected na harvest, hindi ganun kalaki. So ang Isabela miller and traders bumili sa Pangasinan and Baybayseha. So kaya lalo sumipa yung presyo.
But the agriculture department still expects rice prices to remain stable.
Titingnan namin yan at kung may makita kami na nagmamanipulate, yan ang bili ng ating Pangulo. Kanina sinabi rin ni Secretary Chu Laurel na patuloy yung pagbusisi at pag-imbestiga dito sa mga nananamantala sa ito.
Meanwhile, higher inflation was recorded in some commodities such as clothing and footwear, and housing, electricity, and water. Core inflation, on the other hand, dipped further to 5.3%. The country's headline inflation was below the Philippine Central Bank's inflation forecast of 5.1 to 5.9%. As headline inflation inches closer to the government's target rate of 2 to 4%, BSA sees inflation heading south.
If we don't see any shocks, supply shocks, our view is that inflation rate would go down. Although may mga konting threats tayo sa pagtaas ng presyo, like dito sa milk, dairy, yung eggs, no? Tumataas siya, although yung kanyang weight sa basket hindi naman substantial.
National Economic and Development Authority Secretary Arsenio Balisacan emphasized that monitoring of price of commodities is crucial amid global threats. The Economic Development Group earlier recommended extending reduced tariff rates to temper inflation. Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno said government is addressing non-competitive practices to ensure that lower tariff rates do not translate to higher profit margins for importers, traders, and middlemen. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Chris Hedges. Violence is a disease that corrupts all who use it, regardless of the cause.
And that is the world tonight, the 7th of November, 2023. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!